Shepherd this morning. We want to welcome you all here. We also want to welcome you if you're joining us online. Please feel free to text us or to email us. Let's all rise now. We open in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please greet each other.
Today with open hearts and minds ready to worship and praise your holy name. We ask that you bless this time of worship so that we may be uplifted and inspired by your presence. fill us with your love and grace, and help us to honor you in all that we do. In Jesus' name.
Some people think you're distant, just some words on a page. But you're nothing more than fables handed down along the way. We've seen you part the waters when no one else could pull me from the depths. Who you are to me.
Some people think you're living, cathedrals made of stone.
Talking about worship, and I want you to—I want you to put your hands on your wallet or your purse, all right? And then I want you to go like this: hands on your wallet or purse. It can be imaginary purse, right? And go like that. Everything you have from God comes from God into your wallet. That's what happens. Did I just ask for it? No. But there's an important part of worship. We're going to talk about what Jesus encountered when he went to worship one day at the temple. And it wasn't good. And it was all about the wallet. And it was all about what the church was doing. And it was all about the disgrace of what the people of the time had done with money and commerce to the church. And therefore to their relationship with God and their relationship with the priests and each other. So let's bow our heads and go to the Lord, and then we're going to do the announcements. Dear Heavenly Father, we confess that we are sinful by nature. You can repeat with me, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we confess that we are sinful by nature. We have sinned against you in our thoughts, our words, and our actions. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as we love ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Jesus wants when we come here to come with unburdened hearts. So the reason why we confess is so that the things that are burdening us throughout the week, that together we can confess them. And we hear the words of Jesus telling us we are forgiven, acknowledging to us that God sees us and forgives us because of Jesus. So hear those words. We are all forgiven in the name of the Father, the Son, and in the Holy Spirit. What Jesus forgives in you, let no one remind you of or hold against you ever again. Amen.
For announcements, we have First Communion classes coming up, so Sunday, March 17th and March 24th. If you're second grade and older, we can do First Communion, and we'll have First Communion for those on Easter Sunday, so that'll be really exciting. And then also Easter flowers can be ordered until March 10th, so you'll see a available form to fill out to get Easter flowers ordered. Thanks.
So would you join me now as we profess our faith in the form of the Apostles' Creed? Let's rise. And as you're saying these words, remember that these words have been being said before the Lord to each other since 300 AD. So we're professing our faith in the same way the saints that went before us have professed it, and the way we are professing it now all around the world. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated.
Breaking through.
speak what is true. Speak what is true. Speak what is true.
Our scripture reading today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 2. The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons, and the money changers sitting there. And making a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and oxen, and he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And he told those who sold the pigeons, "Take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of trade." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." So Jesus said to him, "What sign do you show us for doing these things?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking about the temple of his body. When, therefore, he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken.
The kids come forward. Come on up. She didn't want Greeny to speak. You want to talk to Greeny? Hello. How are you today? Good. Are you good? All right. Are you ready to go to Children's Church? Oh, look. We got some more coming up. Oh, wow. Love the hair, ladies. It's awesome. So, I was wondering, do you know how to interpret dreams? Does anyone get dreams before? Well, there was this guy named Joseph, and his brothers sold him off. And then, after they sold him, he was put in a king's house, and then he was put in jail. And then after he was put in jail, there were problems. The king was having bad dreams. And so he needed someone to tell him about them. And guess who knew how to interpret dreams? Do you know? Joseph, that's right. Good. Yeah, Joseph. So guess what you're going to do? You're going to learn today in Children's Church what Joseph did and how he interpreted the king's dreams. So why don't you go back and get ready for Children's Church. Go right back there. Back there, see? Way, way back there. Go. And thank you for coming up. So in our prayers today, I'm asking you to pray for the Han family. They are good friends of Donna's and mine, and the Hans are in their 90s, and Mrs. Han is going home to the Lord. She came home from the hospital, and we received word from her daughter that she's entering hospice, and they don't believe it's going to be that long. So just keep the Han family in your prayers. We also have a prayer sheet here, so if you would like to get somebody prayed for on the altar and during the week, please turn in your prayer card. You don't have to give us any information at all, but what you can do is if you want to just put, you know, pray for on the back of it, and whoever you want us to pray for, we will do that. So let's bow our heads now. Father in heaven, we thank you for life and breath today. We thank you for the joy of getting to worship you. We thank you for the joy of hearing your word. We thank you for the joy of getting to sing and now to get to pray with you and to you. Lord, we ask that you'd hear our prayers, Lord, in your mercy. Father in heaven, we thank you for your church around the world. Your church is imperfect. It's made up of people who are imperfect, who sin, who do the wrong things, but also who through your Spirit gathered together as the people of God, you work through all of us, imperfect as we are, to serve the world around us, to love others as you have loved us. Lord, we pray that you would constantly raise our arms, open our eyes and our ears to go out and to serve and to be your people who worship you and serve you in the community. Lord, in your mercy. Father in heaven, we thank you that you are bringing spring. We thank you for the warmer weather, and we pray, Lord, that you would bless all the farmers and all who are growing crops. We pray that you bless their fields and give them a double portion for their work. Lord, you have given to them the task of bringing food from the ground. Bless that task so that the communities around them, the nation around them, and the world around them may have food. Lord, in your mercy. Father in heaven, we thank you for all of the different vocations you give each one of us, the jobs that each of us have. Lord, you have designed each one of us fearfully and wonderfully made, and you have given us gifts that we can serve with. Lord, we thank you for making us all different, for giving us all different ways to serve. And Lord, we thank you for the privilege of being able to worship you with those gifts and to serve those around us in the unique way you have created each one of us and in the unique way you have created us as a congregation. Lord, in your mercy. Father in heaven, we pray for those who are ill, those who are in need, those who are coming to you with various requests and supplications. We ask you to hear their prayers, Father. Lord, we pray for April, for Scott, for the Hahn family, for Brenda, for Corrine, for Whitney, for the Hanley family, for the Flores family, for Annabelle, for Susan, for Joe, for Frankie, for Karen, for Carrie, for Melissa, for Vince, for Catherine, for Beth, for Kathy Behrens, for Mary Sue Thurman, for Tom Thurman, for Laura, for Judy, for Linwood, for Jackson, and for Andy. Lord, as you have put these names on our hearts, we know that you see their burdens, and we know that you see their needs and will answer prayers according to your will. Lord, we ask you also to hear the names that we call out from our hearts, Lord. For Larry. Father, as you have heard those who we call out, we implore you to act according to your will. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory.
Thank you.
morning. So I talked about money starting off. How many of you, raise your hand, thought that I was going to then start saying, you need to give us money, you need, and start pounding on you about everything? How many of you thought that? Well, you would be right. That's what I'm going to do. No, I'm kidding. No, it's important for us to understand when we come to worship that everything we have is from God. I'd like you to take a breath. Just go like this. That breath that you have, your very life, comes from God. It says in Genesis when the world was created, that God just spoke and things started to happen. It says in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And then it goes on and on and on. And then on the sixth day, he creates his most wonderful, beautiful creation in all the world. That's us. And so I want you to ask the question, if we are the pinnacle of what God has created, everything that he wanted everything to be, and so he creates us as living and breathing things, human beings, do you think he would ever boil our existence down to a wallet? Down to a check? Down to currency and things like that? That's not what God is about. It's entirely different than that. So I want to tell you a story, and I want you to kind of put yourself as one of the customers in this story, or a waitress in the story, or anybody else that you hear. Just think as you're listening to the story, who would I be? So I'm in this restaurant, and all of a sudden there's kind of this light gas. When you go to the bathroom, there's this light gas smell. Okay, you didn't get it. Okay. So you go to the bathroom, and there's this light gas smell, and the kitchen is just over here. So a bunch of people go and smell it. They don't think anything, and they go back to their seats. And I went, and I was like, huh? I told the manager about it. Somebody else goes. And finally, someone went up, and there was this long conversation with the manager. Meanwhile, the place is packed. Waiters and waitresses are going all over. You've got three or four cooks in the back. You've got people serving up on the line, making sure all the dishes are checked. This place is running efficiently. It is a machine to deal with hundreds and hundreds of people every morning. This person goes up, and you see this conversation with the manager. And all of a sudden, the manager doesn't say anything, but says, I would like you to all get up right now and leave. What do? You haven't smelled the gas. You're a cook. You don't know anything about it. You're a waitress. You're dependent on all of the wages you're making there, all the tips. How do you react when the manager just comes up and says, we all need to get out of the building now. Would you please follow me? Now, me? I'm sitting, the building's going to blow up. I'm getting out of here. Oh, my God! But do you know what happened in that room, literally? The waiters and the waitresses started complaining. They started saying, I'm going to lose my tips. The people at the tables eating, do you know what they said? They said, I just got my meal. Nobody had paid for anything, mind you, okay? So nobody's paid for anything in the room. They're all eating. Please leave the room. They're all complaining about their particular portion of life and who they are. The cooks are like, all this food is going to be wasted. It's hot. It's ready to go. And so everybody goes outside. Now here's the kicker. The fire marshal comes. Building's all cleared out. And fire marshal checks every place and says, I don't smell it. They check the gas, and they say, we're going to stay here for a while. You might as well all go home. And people are still upset leaving. The thing you needed to know in this story is that a week and a half to 2 weeks earlier, in the county where we were, and it was about 4 miles from this building, this restaurant. An entire building, 5 stories high, had blown up during the breakfast hour on a Sunday. They weren't open. It blew the building out, and it blew the corresponding buildings on either side of it, blew windows out, and everything was destroyed. And yet, these people were concerned when they heard that there might be a problem about their meal that was going cold. Some of them were complaining about money when they hadn't even paid for anything. The only person that understood was the store manager. And the store manager had lost half a day's revenues. All of the people that were employed had to go home. And so there's only one person that really understood that they were protecting everybody. I want you to say this: God protects me. Say it. Yeah. Yeah, see, when you come to church, do you think that God is protecting you when you come here? Say it again. God protects me. So Jesus is strolling along. He's been in the temple once before as a child, and he went, his parents lost him, and he's sitting there talking with the guys like me, the priests, except I'd be one of those dumb priests. I'm not one of the ones that knows everything. And so he's talking with them, and they're amazed at how much this little kid knows. And his parents come back to find him at age 12, and they're all concerned that they've lost him and everything. He says, "Didn't you know I needed to be in my father's house?" At that point, God is saying through this little child, "I am on the scene. I'm here with each one of you. I'm here. God is in the house." You know what the strange thing is? They didn't think that way. They didn't think that God would walk in the flesh into the house. What they thought is that God was over the altar and in the smoke and in the burnt offerings and everything, that he was there in the most inner sanctum of the temple. They never dreamed that he'd actually walk in the place. And so here's what Jesus finds when he goes approximately 18 years later to the temple. He goes and he finds money. Money's not a bad thing. But what he finds is people are taking money and they are exchanging it for temple money so they can offer offerings that they need to. But what's going on is the money changers are taking a cut of the exchange. Also, I want you to imagine if you had to go to your local farm here. Let's say you had to pick up a goat that was perfect. So we go to someone who brings up goats. Who doesn't like baby goats? You go and you pick up the baby goat. It's prancing around and everything. And you are in a VW bug. And you put the goat in the back seat. Now you have to travel 200 or 300 miles with the goat in the back seat to go to take it to the temple to offer it at the altar. Are you really going to want to do that? In your little compact car? So what happens is it was okay to provide animals to be sacrificed. You would leave your goat at home and you would come and you could buy a goat. It wasn't that. It's that it was, if you want the really great goat, the one that's perfect, no blemish on it, well, that's gonna cost you $500. If you want just the ordinary goat, that might be $200. And if you want the one that's all muddy and that just is terrible, maybe that's $50. So Jesus is walking into this. He's seeing at his church, as he walks in, this big, huge money exchange going on. And it says, "Zeal for my Father's house will consume me." So he takes that whip and he's overturning these tables. And he's not really whipping people to harm them. He is taking the zeal for what God wanted in worship, and he is applying it to the place. there's this passage in Zephaniah that's really cool. It's at the end of the book, and I'm sorry, it's Zechariah, and in chapter 14, in 21. It says that eventually that the things that are holy in the temple will no longer be holy in the temple. They will come to us in our own homes. In our own homes where we live, where nobody sees us, where all of the sin is happening in our mind, and where we say things behind closed doors that no one wants to hear, that we don't want anyone to hear. All that stuff that goes in your private places. It says that those utensils, it says that that holiness will be in the home. And that the people should rejoice about it. Jesus is coming into this temple for that very purpose. He's coming in to say, no longer are you going to have to offer money to have your sins taken away. By the way, if you're feeling really sinful, I am willing to accept a really nice brunch dinner after church. And I guarantee you that I will forgive you. So you got that going on, and Jesus is coming into this temple and he's saying, no. You are the pinnacle of God's creation. You, the church, are the ones that God wants communal relationship with. He wants none of this. And he clears it out. What do you think happened when that happened? The entire operation of the temple stopped. Nothing could go on. There were no longer any animals going in to be sacrificed. So, you know, that long line of people hoping it was their calf is going to be offered now. They're going to be atoned for their sins. It's going to the priest. The priest acknowledges that he's received it. He takes it in and he sacrifices it. And the person can say, dear God, thank you for forgiving me. And they could turn around, get in their VW bug, and go home. All of that stops. How do you think the people would react? The priests are going to be livid. Because Jesus has just walked in and basically said, I don't want any of this. Do you know the other reason why the priests are going to be livid? Because guess what they get to eat from? The offerings. So there is a little bit of truth in, by the way, if you want to offer a nice prime rib steak today, I will bless it before the altar, and then I will go home and put it on my grill. See, what's going on? That's how the priests lived. The offerings were given to them so that they could sustain themselves. They were supposed to be holy before the Lord and the people, and they were supposed to act in such a way that people knew God was present in their life, and that people knew that their sins were forgiven. There's a story of Eli. Have you ever heard of the story of Eli and Samuel before? It's in 1 Samuel. Well, Eli has two sons. And in this story, Eli's sons are no good. How many of you have good for rotten, good for nothing sons? Anyone want to raise? How many of you are one of those people? So what's going on is they're supposed to be priests before the people. And they are supposed to be this representation of holiness before the world. It said that when the offerings came in that they were supposed to eat, certain offerings they were only allowed to eat in the inner sanctum of the temple. And when those offerings had been offered, when they touched the offerings, the priests were made holy. So there was this interaction of the priests preparing themselves from unclean to being clean, to being made holy before the people, and for doing the right things before God. Eli's sons, they went out and they said, give me the meat that's raw. And they did it before it ever got into the temple. That was a no-no. Because what would happen if you gave me, if I stood outside and said, I'll take your money now, please. Thank you. Thank you very much. And you all put it in and you go home, but I never take it up here and I never come into the church, bless it, and say thank you for this offering. What goes into your mind when you drive out? Did that money ever get to the church? Did that offering ever get where it was supposed to be? Are my sins in those days forgiven? And do I stand righteous before the Lord? Well, Eli's two boys were taking the meat and going and having a grilling party with it, and they were threatening people that if they didn't give it to them the way they wanted it, that they wouldn't accept the offer for atonement. They wouldn't accept the offering, which then turned the person away, and they went back home feeling unforgiven. That's what was going on. Do you know what happened to Eli and Eli's two sons? God punished Eli for not taking his sons out of temple service and for dealing with them the way God wanted them to be dealt with. So not only did God take out the two sons and kill them, but he also let Eli die and he cursed Eli's family name. Tells you a lot of what should be happening in the church. Tells you a lot about what I should be doing, what we should all be doing as a people together. God means business. There's certain things he wants to happen here. And so